So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَنْزِعُ عَنْهُمَا لِبَاسَهُمَا لِيُرِيَهُمَا سَوْآتِهِمَا. Look at what he did to Adam and Hawa alayhim as-salam. He displayed their shame. Allahu Akbar. He made them shameful of what they did. And this is why one of the primary issues when it comes to shaitan and the devil is that when you follow his path, when you sin, the first thing that happens, you become shameless. You know, when Adam alayhi salam and Hawa alayhi salam, when they sinned in Jannah, the first thing that happened, their private parts appeared, though they were covered before that. They appeared and it resulted in them drawing from the leaves of Jannah in order to cover their private parts. They felt the shame and they did not have to do that in the past. And the Mufassireen have made mention, some of them have spoken about how when a person commits a sin, the first thing it does, it makes them shameless. And it makes them from amongst those who promote, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, immorality, unless they turn and repent. And look at what Adam alayhi salam said. Immediately after committing the sin, he realized he was wrong. And he says, رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِن لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. Oh, our Rabb, we have oppressed ourselves, really. And if you are not going to forgive us, you are not going to have mercy on us, then indeed we will be from amongst the losers. So ya Allah, forgive us. And Allah says, we forgave him straight away. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about those who take shaitan as their protector, and those who befriend shaitan, and those who allow themselves to have a link with the devil. Obviously, that devil would come to us either in the form of a whisper from the devil or in the form of a human being. Whenever there is a person with bad qualities, remember, you should not befriend them. Stay far away from them, no matter what. Because shaitan will come to you through them. And this is how we get entrapped by shaitan. He uses evil people to come to us and to befriend us and to be in our circle so that we become evil with them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about and this issue in Surah Al-A'raf, Allah says, فَرِيقًا هَدَى وَفَرِيقًا حَقَّ عَلَيْهِمُ الضَّلَالَةِ. There are two groups. A group that Allah has guided and a group that is deserving of misguidance. Why would a group be deserving of misguidance? Allah says, إِنَّهُمُ اتَّخَذُوا الشَّيَاطِينَ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ وَيَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. They have indeed taken the devil as protectors besides Allah, and they feel that they are rightly guided, yet they are astray. How can we take the devil as a protector besides Allah? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the devil. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala thereafter tells us that there are people who think they are guided, yet they are in misguidance, because that's what shaitan does. Shaitan misguides us to the degree that we think we are doing a good job, but we are not. One of the negative effects of shaitan is that a person who is in the clutches of the devil will always think they are doing right, yet they will be doing wrong and they will be engaged in evil. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about how shaitan beautifies the evil. And in many places in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَزَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَعْمَالَهُمْ. Shaitan has beautified for them. Shaitan has made fair seeming for them their evil deeds. Shaitan has made fair seeming for them their evil deeds, which means he beautified the evil deeds. So a person comes and he'll argue with you, telling you, no, this is right, this is definitely right, there's nothing wrong with this, come on, what am I doing? It's not wrong, how can it be wrong? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, look, I am calling you towards goodness, the devil is calling you towards evil. If there is any rule that I have laid, Allah tells us, then you should know that it is a rule to enhance yourself in every single way. Success lies in following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, following the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Success will not come to us just by us sitting down and making a prayer for success. We need to make an effort as well. A huge effort is required to adopt the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as well as abstain from prohibitions. This brings us to the next point. What shaitan does when he wants to entrap the Muslims, He makes them, and I think a lot of us are guilty of this. Shaitan makes us feel that we only have to fulfill the commands. And he makes us forget about abstaining from prohibitions. So you find a man, mashallah, with a long beard, with a huge turban, reading salah in the first saf or in the second saf, always there, mashallah, promoting good, telling everyone to read salah, going to everybody's home, inviting them towards Islam. But when it comes to backbiting, he's not worried. It's like not even a sin. He says, look, I'm reading my salah, I'm giving my zakah, I've been for hajj, I fast in the month of Ramadan, I've said my shahada, now what am I worried about? That man is in the clutches of shaitan. May Allah protect us. And it would be me or you if we do the same. Remember, in the same way that there are commands, there are prohibitions. What shaitan does, he'll then tell you, no, I am already dressed properly, so I'm a better Muslim. Allahu Akbar, there are some people who might not be dressed like you, but they might be even better Muslims. They might have a deed that Allah loves more than any of the deeds that I have done or you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is why when a person belittles the sin of backbiting, of deceiving, of cheating, of slander, of lying, of causing disunity and so on, these are major, major sins. When people belittle them and don't regard them as big sins, and people continue engaging in them, then it is time for them to understand and realize that they are in the clutches of the devil. If they do not turn as soon as possible, wallahi, it will result in their destruction and regret in the hereafter. And this is why in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in a different wording, Allah says, it is 10 times more difficult to protect a good deed after it is done. It is 10 times more difficult. To read salah is the easiest thing you could do. I can read salah now. We've just stood, mashallah, for so long for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether or not that salah is going to remain with me up to the day of judgment is a different issue altogether. Because as soon as I go out of here, if I backbite someone, there is a chance that my salah will now go to them because I need to pay for that. It's a fine. And if I have deceived someone, my zakah goes to them. If I have slandered someone, accused them of adultery, which is one of the biggest crimes, my hajj goes to them. When I come on the day of Qiyamah, there will be nothing left. So we belittle this issue. That's why the Quran says, مَنْ جَاءَ بِالْحَسَنَةِ فَلَهُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا. Allah says, whoever comes on the day of Qiyamah with a good deed, we will multiply it for them by 10. But whoever does a good deed, is it immediately multiplied? No, it's not immediately multiplied. According to the tafsir of this verse, which is also mentioned in a book known as Ma'ariful Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that to do your deed is easy, but if you come with it on the day of Qiyamah intact, still in that jewelry box, then we will multiply it by 10 because you deserve the multiplication. You have protected it. You did your deed and you carried on doing good and you did not worry about others. You didn't give away your deed. And this is why one hadith says, أَتَدْرُونَ مَنِ muflis. Do you know who is the bankrupt person? In a nutshell, the hadith tells us a bankrupt person is the one who comes with a lot of salah, a lot of zakah, a lot of good deeds on the day of Qiyamah, but they have backbitten this one, sworn that one, slandered that one, accused this one. So the salah goes there, the good deeds go there, they owe that one, they owe this one. They are left with no good deeds and they still have a line of people waiting, saying, but they've also cheated us and lied about us and so on. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the evil deeds of those people are then taken and put onto that person, and then this person is cast into hellfire. Yet, when they came into that particular day of Qiyamah, they had lots of good deeds. These are the people who did not protect their good deeds. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never ever make us entrapped by shaitan. This is why a question every single one of us needs to ask ourselves every day: how did shaitan come to me today? Because anyone who thinks shaitan did not come to them within a period of 24 hours is a fool. Allahu Akbar. Shaitan has tried his luck with me and you. Every day, every time of the day, he is trying his luck. He promises Allah solid promises. We read some of them tonight. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, he is telling me and he is telling you that I'm going to lead them astray. I promise you, I swear an oath that I will lead them astray. And he brings forth yet another issue. What else does shaitan do? And let's look at some of the things he does. وَيَتَعَلَّمُونَ مِنْهُمَا مَا يُفَرِّقُونَ بِهِ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ. Shaitan, one of his biggest jobs that he loves doing is to separate husband and wife. Allahu Akbar. So a small thing happens and husband gets irritated. Small thing happens and wife gets irritated. That is shaitan's plan. The next time you feel the irritation, before you scratch where it's itching, ask yourself, who is making me itch here or scratch here? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Sometimes a little bit of silence will help. Sometimes a smile, when things are tense, will actually ease a lot of things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us within our homes with a lot of happiness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the devil. He must never be allowed to enter the house. Another thing shaitan does, he makes us angry. Anger is from shaitan as well. Because when a man is angry, he says things, he does things without thinking. The devil is thinking on his behalf. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. That is why when one youngster came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and asked him, "Oh Messenger of Allah, give me advice." He says, "Don't get angry." He says, "Okay, give me more advice." He says, "Don't get angry." He says, "Okay, give me more advice." He said, "Don't get angry." Allahu Akbar. He kept on repeating it. Because anger is the root of a lot of regret in life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So many people have issued talaqs to their wives in anger. And then they come and they say, "But I didn't know what I was doing." Well, why did you utter those words? They are sacred words, dangerous words. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never ever make us from amongst those who cannot control our temper and anger. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then tells us that another act of shaitan, what he makes us do, whenever there is some important information, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there are some people who don't know who to tell that news to. They go and tell it to everyone. If it's a piece of good news, you don't need to tell everyone. Some people might become jealous of you. And if it is a piece of bad news, you don't need to tell everyone. Some people might become happy that you were inflicted with bad. And sometimes if it is to do with security, or if it is to do with goodness or evil regarding the entire community, you need to know where that news needs to go. Because as Muslims, let me inform you, if you have a dispute with someone, the correct Muslim Islamic approach is to resolve the matter. Not to go out to the rest of the globe and spread the issue, but you need to sit together, resolve the matter, come out with a smile, our problem is solved. Allahu Akbar. When you see someone engaged in something wrong or evil, shaitan will make you want to go out and broadcast that evil. Because that's man, that's the nature of man. Man wants to come out and prove that everyone else is bad and I am right. I am the one who's good. Allahu Akbar. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no, that's not the way of doing things. If it is a believer, you've seen them sinning. The truth of the matter is you meant to go to them and try and solve the matter. Look brother, look sister, this is not good. I won't tell anyone, but this is something, you are in the clutches of shaitan. Talk to them, address them. That is the right way of doing things. Because now you want to resolve the matter. You don't want to promote the matter. But the honest truth is modernization has taught us to promote everything. Anything bad or good, just tell the whole world before you even resolve it. So now tomorrow, even if that problem is solved, rumor will still be spread and we will be the source. And remember, whenever someone spreads rumor of someone else, they will taste the punishment of that before they die. They will taste it before they die. So that is why it is very important that we don't fall into the clutches of shaitan by spreading rumor about others.